No, it's very loud. It's very loud. It's too loud. So, welcome everybody. Thank you for coming to this conference. This is the hottest Java conference in the world. Well, actually it's not that hot this year, luckily. We are very, very happy that you came. And I'm very, very grateful to my co-helpers, we co-disorganizers. We call ourselves disorganizers because nothing is organized here. It might look like it's organized, but it's not. It's pretty chaotic. I mean, if you ask... Yeah, exactly. Anything organized, that's Stephen, right? Stephen is the guy who's... Like having cameras and that's really cool. Now, there are a whole bunch of people I'd like to thank. Normally people you thank at the end, but I want to thank at the beginning. And I want to start with Dimitri. Thanks for doing the chief disorganization of the... So Dimitri is going to explain to us exactly how this whole process works, because a lot of you came to me before and said, how does this work? You know, Kai's wife was very suspicious of this whole thing. Yeah, so you're going to be like, you're going to spend like half the day in sessions and the rest on the beach? Yes. You know, this is one conference where we don't actually pretend to work. We pretend to not work, and then we actually end up doing work. So it's a bit different to most. And very happy to have so many people come back as well. Peter and Martin, thank you very much for coming back. And all of you, actually, those who've come back. Stephen for bringing 70 kilograms of equipment from the States.
They got up to 120.
Really?
I think so.
Wow. 120.
Judging by the reports.
Okay. That could be about right, yeah. But so many, Mark, for your constant support, Abia, and there's the guy who actually started it all, John. John contacted me a few years ago, 2010 I think it was, and he said to me, it would be so nice if we had a multi-day conference in Greece. We didn't have any multi-day conference, we had like one day here and one day there. And Kirk and I had before, a few years before, spoken about the idea in Stavros Beach, you know, with our heads out the water, popping around and talking about one day we should have like this exclusive event, you know, invitations only event, that you get like this gold-lettered letter invitation. We're not there yet, we'll get there eventually, you know, to get the gold-lettered invitation letter. That was the idea, and so we've got this, but it's a very different format to what you normally have. I mean, even the arrangement of the seats is very unusual. You know, in theatre, you know, you never turn your back on anybody, right? Here, you have to turn your back on somebody all the time, but the idea is to talk with one another, and Dimitri will talk about how that all works. So, one thing which I'm very grateful for is that so many of you came. And in fact, we only had one person who... Two people missed their flights, three people missed their flights. I think two of them are still coming, and one person couldn't get a visa, or no, he had a visa with Canada, of course, problems with Canada, right? obviously, Canadian problems, right? But besides that, you all came, and I'm really grateful. I was actually quite anxious about this whole thing. I didn't tell you that. But, you know, when I saw the queues at the ATMs and, you know, we don't take cards, we only take cash, you know, that, oh boy, this is going to be fun, you know, trying to feed 100 people on, I don't know, olive oil and watermelons. that would have been quite challenging. And actually, you guys are very brave. I must tell you, you should clap for yourselves. One of my neighbors has a little guest house. They had 40 cancellations. 40. Out of 42. Okay. That's a disaster. for that. It's a real, real problem. So you guys didn't cancel, you came, and so thank you very much, appreciate it. John's going to talk about all the excursions, I presume? And you want, no, unless Dimitri's. I keep on forgetting names, I'm really bad at names, so sorry about that already. Just the barbecue last night, you guys and I put in a bunch of money to buy beers and drinks and beers and drinks and more beers. And I mean, I bought a lot of beers and I got there, and there are like 1,000 beers here already, so I don't know where they all came from. And Ian didn't come in time to help us, so we struggled with those. But, so you guys put on how much, 100? 200?
100 beers, 96 beers.
Yeah, but how much money did you put in?
100
euros. 100 euros? I put in 500 euros. So basically, if you had dinner last night here, just throw in what you think, so between 5 and 10 euros. We'll pass the hat around, and then whatever's left over after the 600 euros, we'll use for beers for the rest of the week. So lastly, I want to also welcome a very special friend of mine, Peter Carruthers. He always does that to me because he does this really good webinar, regular webinar, and whenever I'm there, he's like, oh, there's Hyde Scott. So Peter started a newsletter about 16 years ago, and my dad sent me one of his newsletters. It's about business, how to sell, how to market, how to run a business. And my dad loved it, so he sent it to me, and I basically, everything that he did, I copied. So I just copied everything, but of course for Java specialists. So the newsletter, the whole idea was from Peter's newsletter, and the style was from Peter's style. Even the format was from Peter's format. You know? So I basically just copied everything he did. So yeah, in most ways, right? So you actually can thank him for being here, because if it wasn't for the newsletter, you wouldn't even know that I exist. And you wouldn't be here sitting in Crete for sure. I wouldn't be sitting here either in Crete. So thank you very much. With that, thanks to all of you, and let's hand over to Dimitri.
Okay. Good morning, everyone. Can you hear me? I guess. Yes, you can. Okay, thanks for coming. This is awesome. This is like year number 5. We are bigger, stronger than ever. Just look at that. This is like, you know, spaceship technology. I mean, he's not from this planet, I tell you. When he's unpacking, like everybody, like all the engineers, you know, like Java champions, like blind, like brain like flat, doesn't work, you know, you don't understand what he's doing. So I want to thank Stephen Chin for doing all that. He's gonna explain what he's doing, but just round of applause for him, he's awesome. Part of the reason why we are so many this year is because he was here last year and he just streamed it online, he tweeted about that, and all of a sudden 5,000 people like emailing Heinz, I want to come, you know, like I'm the best in my whatever world thing. Like, no, I don't know you, you don't get invitation anymore. So, Stephen, can you explain us how the setup works, please?
I'm gonna demonstrate how this works. Okay, so. All right, can everyone hear me pretty clearly? Okay, so this microphone and the two microphone on our unconference organizers, those are the mics which they both go out to the live stream and they also go out to the speakers in the room. The guys you see on the ground here, these are called boundary microphones. And even though you're not holding one of these and you can't be heard on the loudspeaker, you're still being picked up. Especially if you're in the front row. So sit in the front row. And the idea is that this way, for you know, all of the thousands of people who want to come here, who either can't make it here because there's not enough slots or because it's too far to travel. I was on the road for 24 hours to get here from San Francisco. But they can watch it live at nighthacking.com. So this is, whatever is up on screen is actually what's being broadcast over the live stream. And you can go to the website, but please don't. we have limited bandwidth here, but you can go to the website and you can watch the live stream, which is going on right now. So let me explain a bit about the finer points of how not to break the setup. Okay, so if you noticed, when I'm holding the mic here, I kind of face it towards my face. And the trick with this microphone, the reason it doesn't get an echo loop with the speakers is because it's a cardioid mic, so it only picks up voice like, you know, in a cone pattern. So if you hold it like this, no good. Nobody's gonna hear you. You wanna hold it towards your mouth. So that's the trick with this microphone. These microphones, they're pretty good at not picking up like shuffling noises or stuff that's nearby them. But if you're in the front row, like eating a sandwich or something, you know, yum yum, it'll all come out over the speakers. If you clap, people will hear you clapping very loudly. I'm not saying don't clap, but you know, golf clap. Let's see, what else about the setup? Oh yeah, don't trip over the wires, please. If you stand in front of the cameras too close, then your head will get cut off like this. Or you can block the camera entirely if you don't want to see it. For our presenters, we have a HDMI cable over here. And when you hook your laptop up to the HDMI cable, I'll push a button on the setup over here, and that's going to put your video up on screen. Let's see, let's not block the cameras like I said I should. So that'll put your video up on screen, and then you'll be able to see like a picture-in-picture. So either full screen with your laptop or laptop plus an overlay of the two speakers or whatever we want to do. I'll try at various points to start and stop recording so we can also post the sessions online afterwards as little chunks. So folks, if they want to watch later, they can just watch a particular session. May even put a description if I have time. Okay, and let me show you a couple things. Okay, well, we need a laptop hooked up, but this is what it'll look like with, you know, green boxes, laptop. That's the overlay. This is full screen laptop. And this is what my computer looks like with, you know, the broadcast console and stuff. And I'm putting this up for a specific reason because, look here, we've got TweetDeck open. Okay, so recently I switched official jobs at Oracle. So I used to be on the Java Evangelism team, and now I'm the Java Community Manager working for OTN, which basically means I run the Java Twitter handle along with Yolan. So I figured we should post something from the Java Twitter handle from JCreet, announcing the live stream and what we're doing here. So I have a little post with a picture of all of us, and I'm going to push that live now, if it works. Yes. Yay. Okay. So. Okay, and if you guys wouldn't mind retweeting that one. Oops. I'll get it up. So if you wouldn't mind, you know, finding the Java post and retweeting it at some point, then that'll make sure that all your, you know, friends and colleagues and folks are suitably jealous that you're here. And they're not. Let's see. So I think, let me also mention, so we have the 3D printer over there. And the reason I set that up earlier is so we'll have a chance to actually utilize it during the conference. So maybe at some point we can also talk about that, but not now. I think we should get back to the dis organizers.
The dis part organization. Okay, that was the amazing setup. Just one more thing before we go to this organization. This is year number 5 of JCreet, and I would really like to thank the grounding fathers of the whole thing, John Kostaras and Heinz Kabutz. Please round of applause. They brought the thing up. I also like to thank numerous other people like Kurt Pepperdine, Robert Gransberger, lots of supporters, all of you guys for coming, thanks. I hope you're gonna enjoy it if you're here for the first time. If you're a returning customer, so to speak, you know what you're up for, so thanks for coming. Okay, the open space format, how it's gonna work. You see the unusual seating, and probably half of you, I guess, already been to open spaces, so you know more or less the drill. And the thing is, the open space format was invented by the guy called Harrison Owen in mid-80s. He actually had a real problem to solve. He was running a real conference and he was fed up of setting up and organizing that. He needed a more lightweight format. So he just came up with an idea like, let's invite people and give them just the theme, what we're going to talk about. But there is no agenda, no program, no nothing. And the idea is that people self-organize. So what we're going to do is each of you, hopefully, each and everyone, going to propose one or n topics to talk about. You're going to put on a sticker the name of the topic and his name, and then you are becoming a convener. A convener has a responsibility, and the responsibility is to run a session, make sure it's going to happen, you're going to have a discussion, and that outputs of the session are going to be captured. Regarding outputs, we usually put them on a wiki. We're going to put up the URL later, so on Wiki Educator we have a page and format and everything set up. We're going to put the schedule, so as a convener, you will just come to the page, click on the link for your session, and just fill up the details as much as you like. So once everyone proposes a topic, we're going to open the market space, we're going to put them all on Launchpad, we're going to cluster the topics, because we usually have some overlays and overlaps in the topics, and after that we're going to move them to the schedule. So in about an hour time, we're going to have full schedule complete for the whole week, and then we go off the sessions. So this is easy part. We have five principles and one law that kind of guides us through the process. The principles are, whoever comes are the right people. You are here for a reason, you care, obviously, so you come for the session. Whenever it starts, it starts. Basically reminds us that the start of a session is the start of a session, you have to be there, and when it's over, it's over. If you don't finish your discussion, no worries, you can take it elsewhere afterwards. And whenever it happens, it's the right place. It doesn't have to be in session room, it can happen while drinking raki, swimming, going to the excursions. We have even the theme of JCrete, it's called Waving Talks, when the speakers swim like 300 meters from the shore, and then you see heads open up, and then people discuss stuff. Sometimes it's even recorded with the GoPros. So we had it in the past. And the last one, whatever happens is the only thing that could have. Be prepared to be surprised. And we have a guiding law, which says, it's called the law of 2 feet. So if at any point you find yourself neither learning nor contributing, use your 2 feet and go somewhere else. Cross-pollinate, learn from others, bring your ideas, but don't sit there and say, I don't like it, go elsewhere. We'll have 5 parallel rooms this year, so you'll have 5 parallel sessions to go and contribute to. I guess you'll find pretty much everything, that the interesting topic for yourself. And in any case, you can just go and play with 3D printer and just enjoy it. Enjoy your time here. One important bit, for the proceedings that we capture, we post them online. So we ask all the participants to sign the contribution agreement, which we license as Creative Commons license contribution share alike. So it's CC by SA 3.0. You see the paper sheets on that wall. And what you need to do is just put your name and the signature. That also means if you have a corporate slides or something that has a different wording on it or thing that can get you into trouble, don't upload them to Wikipage. As simple as that, just don't share that. You can show it, but just don't put it there so we don't have any collisions and issues. And or the link to whatever speaker's deck. And if that's also an option, so you can share it in other means, but don't put it in Wiki Educator or Wikimedia, so we don't have trouble. So with that, I want to give a word to John Castaras to explain us unofficial part of the fund, which is we have half a day activities, right? Half a day we are spending officially on the conference and sessions, and second half we go in for excursions, beach, the dinners, all that fun stuff. So John gonna say a couple of words how the excursion is gonna work and how you sign up for dinners and do certain logistics before we open up the marketplace.
1, 2, 3, I'm on live, okay.
Yeah, you're on.
So again, thank you for coming, everybody. This is the most unique conference North. because it combines holidays with holidays with conference, a lot of topics. So mainly, what we're going, Dimitri just explained how the procedure works. We're going to get a lot of these, which they're going to put one or two topics. If you want, you have everything. And after we're done, we're going to put everything in the last part. Then we're going to organize things on the main schedule there, and we're going to start the sessions. For the afternoon, after we finish, we can have the our excursions. We sent the schedule. You can have to sign there. There are two papers next to the door. Tonight, this afternoon, we're going to go to Falasana, one of the best beaches in Europe, actually. So whoever wants to follow, and you can find some cars to get a lift with, please sign up and join us. We're going to come back, either we have a dinner here in Kolibari, or if we find, if we're late, we can continue there. This is going to continue tomorrow with Balos. We have to wake up quite early, 6:30, I think. And it's going to continue for Wednesday and Thursday and Friday. And Saturday, for those who don't know, we have a special venue for kids. So if you're around, we'd like for you to help as much as you wish. If you don't speak Greek, it's going to be 100 kids coming around here. And
Stephen,
and Stephen is going to present what we're going to do the hacking day on Friday. We're going to have similar session for Saturday. And the same workshop is going to continue in Heraklion on Sunday, but we are not expected to be there. So that's for me. I can start, I think, with the first to show how we can do the first.
Propose.
Propose. So that's how it goes. So you propose one title in these papers. Please write your full name, because last year we had some problems identifying who was what. Don't put like Ioannis only or John or whatever. Just put your full name there, and then you just say a few things what the topic is all about. Then once you propose a topic, you are supposed to be the convener. So you are responsible also to collect the material that we're going to upload to the Wiki Educator. We have to sign yourselves on the papers on the right there, that all the material that we're going to present here is open source. You can freely distribute it everywhere, because it will be uploaded to Wiki Educator. We don't have recording machines this year, so if you can use your phones to record sessions if you want, it would be nice. And then we can upload everybody to Rabia, I think, or not. Anyway, we find a way.
Now it's Rabia.
Where we can upload them to the Wiki. So that's it for now. Let me propose some sessions. So for me, I'm going to have a presentation discussion about from imperative to functional programming. So mainly what is going to talk about is how we can use some pretty functional ideas like caring or monads or whatever, and how you can do it with Java 8 lambdas. That's the main one of my topics. I'm going to write it down later, but then I put it in the launchpad. Another one is how to resurrect your Java applets. Java applets don't work anymore in modern browsers due to security reasons. So if you have a lot of Java applets, once upon a time there were a lot of Java applets written around in the world, they just don't work today, about physics, for example, education and stuff, or mathematics. What are technologies today that you don't need to write in HTML, but to write in Java and be able to render it in the browser? And then, if these are topics that I can show, but you can also do this one. You can also propose a topic and expect that someone can pick it up. So if Martin Thompson is here, he disappeared apparently. Oh no, he's here. So maybe I would like also to hear something about reactive programming. No, okay, then you're bad luck, sorry. So that's it from me.
Yeah.
Next one, Dimitri, you
can. I can be next one. So the idea is, you propose a topic and you say a couple of words. So it's not just you have this thing and give the sticker to someone. You just have to announce, say your name and what the things are about. So my first one, unsafe, the free lunch is over. So I want to community involvement in discuss what we're going to do about unsafe going away in Java 9, how Java going to die or not die, and what we as a community can do to make sure that either we have back unsafe or we have replacement on time for Java 9. Second thing is lambdas and streams performance gotchas. Kind of discussion show of use cases in which lambdas and streams perform poorly, and what can you do to minimize that impact? I think Peter Laurie has something to say about that as well. So, and that's the second one, and the third one would be JMH benchmarking done right, kind of tell people that JMH exists, and even if you use JMH, it doesn't mean that your benchmarks are correct. I just seen an article in a big German Java magazine where the benchmarks were busted, and there were like several listings on several pages, and they were all broken. And then we use JMH, come on. No, this is just one kind of one. So that's topics from myself, and Andres, you're gonna be next one?
I guess.
Let's put the mic and you can just pass it.
Hello. Hello guys, my name is Andres Amek, and I haven't written yet, but I have a few topics. One of them is JSR 377. For those that don't know, the desktop is still alive. Yes? So JSR 377 is a JSR that tries to standardize APIs to work on the desktop and embedded devices and IoT. So that's one of the things that I would like to talk on. And the other one would be build tools, specifically Gradle. Do you like it? Do you hate it? Do you want to get into Gradle? Is there something that is missing? So these are general discussion about what we can do better or how we can learn better Gradle. Who wants to be next?
Hi, I'm Chris. I'm also going for the some is gun safe road and what is going to happen with Java 9. And the second one is Java 9 in general, what to expect, and what is coming, what is going away, and who is the next one?
Hi, my name is Childrice. I would like to propose a discussion. It's about open source. What tools do you use? IDEA, Gradle, ASCII Doctor, Travis, Coverall, Bintray, and the works. Yeah. So your experiences, I'd love to hear about them.
Thank you. I am Alvaro Hernandez. I'd like to propose those two topics that are not written yet. The first one is about a topic we discussed last year here, which I presented and Steve live streamed, which was about a prototype we were designing, which was called, was a new database written in Java. It's called TorDB. And it's a NoSQL database built on SQL. And that, together with the discussion, helped us make it. And now it's a product, it's open source. And it's released to GitHub. And I'd like to explain what's been going on, how it's going, and the techniques used there, and the advantages that we are getting from the Java world out of this, for this database. So we're going to be presenting this. It's something related to also NoSQL, MongoDB stuff. So if you like that, I know this is a Java conference, but it's written in Java. So you know, should be there. The other topic, Kirk. The other topic I'd like to propose, it's called to DB or to Kirk. This is a recurring topic here in the conference, and I know there's people here in this doing programming in Java, sure, but at some point you need to store data. And there are basically two ideas. Well, there are more, but two probable ideas of how to store data are either use a database or use flat files, or other means. And so this is getting really, really funny. So I like to propose that topic too. Next.
Hello, I'm
okay. Okay. So I've got a couple topics. So first one is 3D printing. So I've got a little Duke picture there, and we just printed our first Duke. You can see him on the table over there. His belly is slightly under extruded, so you can see an example of what a improper 3D print looks like. So, but not too bad for the first one, and we have a second print going. And I think this is an interesting thing as developers. Oh, thank you. To play around with, because you can actually take your ideas and turn them into like physical manifestations of, you know, turn your code into actual devices. And a lot of the 3D printing stuff you can directly code. So there's a Java constructive geometry library where you can directly code your models directly in Java code. Okay, and my second topic, this one I prodded Kirk, so I'm hoping he'll help me out with this one. It's Java Champions Uncensored. So it's not just for Java Champions, this is for anybody who's like interested in the program, has strong opinions about like what Java Champions should be doing or how Oracle should be engaging Java Champions, or you know, in general cares about the Java ecosystem. So this is the uncensored version of
Maybe we should point out that I think there's about a dozen Java champions.
Oh yeah, who's a Java champion in the audience? Oh yeah, we have quite a few. See, you guys are mandatory. All right, and anyone want the mic?
Hi, my name is Antonio. I'm a Java EE 8 expert member, so I feel like I'm obliged to talk about Java EE 8, so I wrote a post-it about it. But if nobody is interested, that's okay, because I'm more than happy to go and do streams and lambdas and stuff like that. Anybody else?
Yeah, hi, I'm Kai Horstman. So I have two things that I'd like to propose. One is I've just looked at Scala.js at some depth. So Scala.js is this amazing thing where Scala compiles, of course, to Java and the JVM, as we know, but also to JavaScript. And so it gives this vision of how one could have a unifying language where you write Scala on the back end and you write Scala on the front end for your UI, which then does all the JavaScripty stuff. And so I can explain what it is, and I'd like to get people interested in it. And I want to know, do we want Java.js? The other topic that I'm interested in is what I'd like to call streams.next. So if you look at the current Java utility of streams, you know, it's kind of nice, but when you compare it to what you have in Scala or in C#, it's kind of limited. So what do we want in the next iteration of it? You know, zipping, grouping, better stream creation, link-like features. So if anyone's interested in that, I'd love to engage them.
Watch out for the mic on your computer.
All right, there are two topics I would like to talk about. A mate of mine is a software architect, and he calls himself the man that says no. And I'd like to explore the word no in a session. The other topic is the human interaction protocol, which is the way that we communicate even here. As I stand here with you guys, I use the human interaction protocol, and I would like to explore that with you a bit more.
Hello. We've been using lambdas for about 12 months extensively, and so we've come across a few interesting features and challenges. So we're going to be talking. One of the topics here is lambdas debugging and profiling, which are a lot of fun. And lambda edge cases, so you can get some really strange things happening. One of my favorites is what happens if you do a compute inside a compute. It depends on the collection. You'll get a different result for just about every collection. More results than you thought possible.
Hello, my name is Jean-Philippe. I have two topics to propose. The first one is on log-free programming in general. Some patterns we can learn. And because we have a Jedi Master in Mechanical Sympathy, I would like to talk about Mechanical Sympathy, so hopefully with Martin.
Okay. My name is Kirk, and I have one topic on general stream performance. Hopefully Maurice will be interested in helping with that one. And another topic, this year has been rather interesting in the sense that a number of things have happened in terms of intellectual property stuff going on. And so I just wanted to give a session about my experiences about protecting IP, your IP. Sometimes defensively, and how to maybe use it aggressively. But mostly, I think for this crowd, most people have to be more defensive about their IP, and that means that you have to start looking at legal and political steps to try to protect it. So that would be my session.
So good morning, my name is Mark. I would like to propose three sessions. One is the topic we already started last year, and as we know, all coding with Java 8, I want to talk about with you and share ideas about idioms and patterns, new idioms and patterns using the Java 8 language possibilities. There's a bunch of new libraries like Java Slang or things like that, so how do they use the idioms besides the Streams API? As I'm working on code coverage tools, I'm deep into creating bytecode, modifying bytecode. If you're interested in, we could do a bytecode engineering hands-on session, like hack some bytecode and see how we can generate it and use it. That's my second session. The third one is a non-technical session. I met Peter. Peter, where are you? Here. Okay. So I'm wondering, what are the non-technical success factors of software projects? I mean, we are all experts in solving technical problems. We are often called to come to problems, to projects which are in trouble, but typically we are tackling the non-technical problems then, because the technical problems are just a symptom of some human issues. And then I have an announcement. Sven Ruppert actually got his flight with Ryanair, and he will arrive 3:30 at Kania. Will somebody be in the area of Kania this afternoon? Just in case. Otherwise, I will pick him up. But if somebody's in the area anyways, then please let me know, or let him know, so then he could get a ride to this place.
Mark.
Hello. My name is Simone. I want to propose three sessions. One is about HTTP2 in Java and what's going to happen in the future, in the near future. Especially with JDK 9, there are a few improvements and few jabs that are being worked on for HTTP2 support. Another thing that it was one of the first proposals was about functional programming and object-oriented programming. We have put up a session, myself and a friend, explaining the two styles and how you can actually get in trouble if you really want to stick with just one paradigm. So, sometimes it's better to be on both sides and choose the one that fits best for your use case. And since Kirk didn't mention it, I would like to talk about G1 and an experience that we had tuning G1 for, and a few more details. It's stuff that I always wanted to know about G1, and I couldn't find enough information around over the internet, so I kind of look it up and then put it up into a presentation. So that's for me. I'm also the swimming teacher. So for those interested, it's going to be, we'll try this afternoon. We'll see on the Falasarna beach how it's going. If it's too windy or not too windy, but eventually everybody interested, let's meet at Falasarna. Thanks. Who's next?
Hello all, my name is Martin, and I'd like to propose two topics. One of the topics is multi-core for humans. We talk a lot about multi-core these days. There's a lot of stuff out there on parallel and concurrent programming. I want to go through and basically take apart a lot of what we talk about in parallel and concurrent programming and show how it doesn't work. Gelson can prove mathematically why it doesn't work, as well as how difficult it is for us as humans to understand it. So that's what I'd like to go through, and also look at what is possible and what options do we have out there. Second topic I'd like to talk about is API design for performance. A lot of the performance issues I get to see in the field for real are not about compiler hacks. They're not about doing lots of weird things to our JVM. Most of the problems are API design. I want to talk about how a lot of OO design, and especially examples we have in the JDK, lead you to really bad performance, and how with just very different API designs, we can have massively better performance. That's my two topics.
Hi, I'm Patricia, and I would like to talk about two topics. The first one is secure authentication and session management. Basically, how you can hijack or use other users' session, and how you can protect in Java against those types of attacks. And the second one is more like open topics, and I would like your participation. It's about concurrency, databases, and web UI. How to make all those things work together properly. Because there are a lot of scenarios, concurrent scenarios, under which there are many bugs and use cases which fail. So I have a couple of examples, and I would like to share with them and also expect some sharing from you. So thank you.
Hi, I'm Marcus, and I'm coming here unprepared in pretty much standard unconference style. I do, however, bring with me all the slide sets I've ever presented at more Java runtimes in some way for the last 20 years. So that's one of my sessions. I can talk about my life with runtimes, being a runtime engineer at various corporations, working on various JVMs for the last 20 years. Mike, sorry. I know people have been wondering about Java 9, so I can bring up what's going on in Java 9, and I especially want to talk about invoke dynamic performance there, and how we get around various performance problems and certain performance problems that we still have to solve, which is like the seed, the embryo of the presentation I'm giving at JVMLS in 2 or 3 weeks. And I have a Java 10 and beyond. What I can tell you that's in the public domain. I'm no longer employed at Oracle, so I mean I can't be punished for what I say anymore. But I certain things are internal. And then I have a small human interest story called acquiring Sun. What we found, we on the other side of the fence when we acquired Sun in 2010, and are we still cleaning up? So.
Hi, I'm Chris. I'd like to propose a talk titled JitWatch by Example. I'd like to basically take some code examples in Java or any other VM languages and take a look at what VICO has generated, what the hotspot compiler does. So was there any escape analysis, lock collision, inlining? I've got some examples, but if you'd like to bring along some of your own examples that you're interested in seeing what the VM does with that code, that's great. So we can do some live coding. So if you're interested in so what happens to your code inside the VM as it executes, then yeah, please come along.
I'm a little bit embarrassed because you're all here because you earn money. And I feel that in this world of open source and all of these noble thoughts, I'm talking about what is effectively prostitution, making money. I'd like to talk about monetizing the skill that you've got, the craft that you guys have. I mean, you're all rock stars in this field. And I'd like to talk about a relatively simple way to stealth brand yourselves, stealth brand anything that you're doing so that you can, well, do anything you want. I've lived off the internet for 20 years and I've been self-employed or unemployed for about 35. I'd love to share how to do that. Thanks a lot. I'm Pete Carruthers, by the way. Sorry. What question already? Microphone.
Yeah. Thank you. I'm Alexei. I worked for Oracle for 3 years, so in Java SE compatibility team. The first thing I want to discuss here is conformance and compatibility. And the second one is, of course, unsafe. Here, on this page, I collect several scenarios of how it is unsafe in our company when I'm working in for the time being. So I think it's a good point to start with. So that's it.
Thank
Hey folks, I'm Attila. I also work for Oracle, mostly in the Masfin team. So I want to make two proposals. One is, well, if you're interested in what does it take these days to actually write a dynamic language runtime on the JVM, I've been working a lot on the compiler, etc. So I'm very happy to ramble at length about various things about bytecode shaping, our optimistic compilation techniques for figuring out data types in a dynamic language efficiently in bytecode, and everything else that we, all the other hoops that we had to jump through in order to make NASFIN run fast. The other topic that I love to talk about is something entirely different, but interestingly it actually ties into general thinking when you spend too much time around compilers, and that's about inherent complexity of computations. That's a pet topic of mine that I love to think about the minimum inherent complexity that you need to express a particular computation in general in classical sense, and whether it is actually possible or even desirable to actually achieve that, and how does this idea survive contact with the physical reality vis-a-vis thermodynamics mostly, and some other aspects. So yep, that's the other one. All right.
Hi, Ian. I didn't want to talk about unsafe, but since about three people have already said that, I'll skip that one. Models of concurrency. So we have things like threads, actors, STM, agents, things like that in the closure world. Which approaches are people using, and any war stories that they've got to talk about. And the other thing I'd like to talk about is Java 10 and beyond. Java 9 seems to be a lot of small changes from a developer's point of view, and then from the language infrastructure point of view, or from a JVM infrastructure point of view, it's a lot of changes with the modularity stuff. But then with Java 10, we've got kind of value types and potentially verified generics. Yeah, maybe. there's a number of big changes that have been proposed for Java 10. Be interested to see if anyone has any opinions about that and how they think it's going to affect their kind of day-to-day work. Are they good ideas, or are they bad ideas?
Hi, I'm Rabia, and my only session I'm going to propose is how to give a talk at the conference. So maybe there's people around which never gave a talk at the conference and probably like some to hear some ideas how to do it, how to submit an abstract and so on, so we can discuss it in a session. There's a lot of speakers around, so you're going to probably get some input. And please, if you do prepare the stickers, don't forget to write down your name, so otherwise we don't know who proposed the talk. So who's next?
Yeah, hi, my name is Jaromir, and I have two proposals. What I call, how open hotspot JVM really is, and that's just another name for unsafe. Right. And the second proposal is why we don't have still postless GC in the hotspot. And that's more like a discussion topic to what are the reasons why Azure is the only generic proposed JVM with postless garbage collector, whether it's a threat for the future when we are approaching gigabytes of hundreds of gigabytes of memory and this sort of thing. So next one.
So hi, I'm Sven, and picking up on the JDK 10 things, I would say Beyond 9 and experiences with the Valhalla prototype, if anybody's interested in talking about that, so sharing things you already did there.
Yeah?
Actually, it was only about unsafe
removal.
Okay. Fucking safe.
Thank you.
Hello, I'm Zoran. I come from the University of Belgrade, and I would like to propose three topics. One is analytics, machine learning, and neural networks in Java. We'd like to hear what frameworks, what tools you are using, and what are you using it for. then multi-threading and distributed computing in Java. There are so many techniques and approaches, and I would like to discuss them and see what are your experience and what works for which problems. And the third session is not Java related, but since I saw that we have experts here, it's about starting up and running international business. Thank you.
Next.
Yeah. Okay, my name is James. First topic I would like to talk about is server-side releases without downtime. This is actually something that we were discussing at AgileCrete last week. So when you have a large migration of data and you want to do that without having to take down the system. The second one is, we all like open source, we all like how it's free and we can investigate it, we can work out what it does and everything. What I would like to talk about is why I don't like open source. That's controversial to try and get people excited about it. Third topic, this one I would like to talk about hot pluggable microservices with OSGI. Who's next?
Thank you, Hank.
Hi, I'm Chris. I have two topics. First one is something that appears to be brewing sort of on the horizon in the future. That's non-volatile main memory. I don't know that much about it myself, but I'm guessing that it's kind of like a hard drive that is as fast or faster than random access memory or DRAM. And then why would you have a hard drive in the first place if you can just have durable memory? Is that going to change how we write programs? When do we still need file systems at that point? And the other topic is because I work for I like to talk about graph databases. What are they and are they awesome? Are they going to eat the world or not?
I'm Alvaro again. I'm still the same. I'd like to propose another topic, haven't read them yet, but it's about consensus algorithms. Who knows what are consensus algorithms?
Yeah. Let's also discuss the cases where they're not required.
That's a good point. Okay, so those of you who know what are, you should probably be convening the session. For those of you who don't know what they are, you should definitely go into the session. They're basically a set of algorithms to manage some problems that I've seen a lot of programmers not being aware of. And they're meant for example, high-availability scenarios, and most of these scenarios fail if they are not running properly under these algorithms. So Paxos Wrapped, there is Zookeeper in Java with its own consensus algorithm, but I'd like to know what is the state of the art, what's your opinion experiences, which ones are you using, which ones are not you using, and what is the state in Java about this?
Hi, I'm Dimitris. I work for Red Hat, obviously. For the Wildfly team, and just want to talk about microservices and look at your experiences or your issues without OSGI. I think it would be quite challenging to sort out the topics. Maybe we have to collapse some of them together.
Hello, my name is Melissa. And I've worked for a few companies now that have adopted some form of Agile. My most recent company just recently adopted this process, and I just want to talk about real life examples of what's worked for you, what hasn't worked for you, and basically anything involving coding as a team.
Those who are Agile today.
Hello, my name is Jan. So basically, I would like to talk about efficient unit testing in complex Java stacks. So basically, the idea is how can you build a unified testing API that you can use on all testing layers that involves end-to-end testing, integrated testing, and unit testing, It gives it a chance basically to reuse the test setup. It means basically regardless where you run the test, basically it's syntactically the same setup. That involves basically, it gives you the opportunity to have virtually no costs for basically separating an integration test to actually a couple of unit tests. And I would like to basically show a real life example which we did or which we're doing currently in a live project and basically discuss pro and cons of that approach.
Hello, my name is Samir. I work at Red Hat as well. And I work mainly on Hibernate. So I would like to propose a topic about what's new in Hibernate, what we're doing in the area of NoSQL and performance improvements. But also like three different area topics. Like one is to maybe share some of the strangest and surprising performance analysis or stories that you might have. I have a couple and they don't even involve Hibernate, but are, I don't know, I still have to figure out if it's a bug in the JDK or something. It gets quite a deep. Then I'm interested in Bytemen and the Joker, who are two fault injections and bytecode scripting tools that we are using for testing or making runtime changes. And finally, I don't work on the Whitefly team, but I obviously have to integrate many of these open source projects within Whitefly. So I'm using the JBoss models system for modularity of cluster builders, and I'm really liking it. So I could talk a bit about that and think what everybody else is. Look what everybody else is thinking of that.
Hi. So my name is Marcus. I work for the Java Project Group at Oracle, and. I don't really want to talk about unsafe, but I'd be happy to talk about some of the interesting tooling that is available in the Oracle JDK. So JCommand, JFR, Java Factory Recorder, that is, and Ignition Control. And depending on the level of knowledge, we could do like introduction, or we can do a deep dive and talk about unsupported functionality and all the fun things you can do with that. You know. So. And also, I'd like to talk about using Java in the cloud. Cloud being all the rave right now. You know, if there is anybody who has experience of running Java in the cloud, if you have pain points, things you would like to see improved. I don't have much experience of running Java in the cloud, so I'm hoping that you would contribute that, but I might be able to contribute maybe solutions to pain points in the future. So. That's my two things.
Hi, I'm Jesper. This is my fifth J3 symposium. This year I'm proposing a talk
about the champion.
Less garbage. I'm very inspired by the high frequency trading guys. I'm not doing high frequency trading systems, but the ideas they have about generating less garbage is very interesting, and I have some experiences trying not to generate too much garbage, and it does something to your code style and it does really tremendous things to your performance.
Hi, I'm Nazi. I'm interested in Java, obviously, but also other non-Java JVM languages, you know, probably I've been doing Scala the last 2 years. I don't think there needs to be a session unless there's many other people interested, but if you want to talk about that on the halls at the beach or anything, I'll just leave the post-it there. So just come by, and if it's very important, we can just have a session on it. Thank you.
Hi everyone, my name is Alex. Frankly speaking, I'm not a Java programmer. I'm a Clojure developer by day and Haskell developer by night. And I came to sabotage this conference. Or unconference. Un-Java it. So everything is un here. So I'm going to talk about lisping a try because, well, the thing is that whenever you're touching, like, whenever you're doing functional programming with the Java, you're kind of like, coming to the lake and trying to put your fingers into it, and well, but you're not really doing it right. Or, I mean, you're doing it right, but you're not doing it fully. So how to dive deep into the Lisp or into the functional programming. The second subject is why you can't program on streams if you're not programming it well, if you're not sufficient with functional programming, and things we've learned while developing new real-time streaming platform. And the third thing is stream fusion. So how to fuse streams, and several papers and research about that topic. So yeah.
Hi, my name is Yorgos, and I'd like to talk about the whole area of DevOps and infrastructure as code. If you've used any tools like Packer, Chef, Vagrant, or any other cloud automation tools. Now, the second topic is, it was actually inspired on a secluded beach that we were with the Agile Creep guys. So we had a very interesting chat about developer ethics. So this will include questions like, are you happy with the impact your work is having on the society? Or do we have special responsibilities in the information age?
I am Bruno.
Two topics we've discussed a lot on the a lot of low-level performance topics, Java algorithms. I'm more coming from the enterprise corner, so I'm using all of that stuff in practice, building quite large systems. And what I'd be interested in are two things, basically, in this context. One is the experiences, thoughts. If you're having you're building a very large application, hundreds of screens, user interfaces, tens of modules, all integrated in the same front end, using today's stack available, what would be your thoughts? Frameworks, front end, data storage, huge sessions. Do you use database? How do you replicate them without having sticky sessions on servers? Do you use in-memory databases? Would you use relational, and so on and so on. So basically, how to structure a huge system using most current stack. And second topic would be, basically also, all of the stuff that we are discussing is relatively complex, not complex for the one who knows how to use it, but what if you're a relatively average developer? So you're developing something, so you can basically take the technology and do a lot of mistakes. You can do a lot of bad stuff with it. So what would be your strategy to make it easier, less error prone, and also 15 years from now? So if you're building a system today, it's supposed to last for about 15, 20 years lifespan, and you use all of the concurrency, all of the locking, all of the Lambda advanced features that we are discussing, what would be your thoughts to make it less error prone for an average developer? Let's say you got 100 of them sitting scattered all over the world, and to make this application also maintainable 15 years from now.
Hi, I'm Mike, and I just have one topic which is probably more suited to Peter Lowry over there, putting some input, which is high volume, not frequency trading, but instruction processing. Indeed, it goes towards the previous topic which was proposed for expanded systems and going forward 10, 15 years, where the volumes are going to increase by a factor of 10 or 100. So.
Guys, I'm Mats.
And let's say this is not a session, but we have here a 3D artist, so Marinko Kobay,
right?
3D designer. A 3D designer, and I brought with me a cardboard at the Oculus DK2. So we will in the breaks maybe have sessions about 3D, and you can try the 3D glasses and see how the future looks. And maybe it's the idea to how to get Java in that areas, because it's now fully C++ area, so that's the future.
It's going to be an on session. Anybody else would like to propose topic?
Hi, my name is Lyusha. So besides serving watermelon, do a couple of other stuff. So I would like to propose cloud microservice performance monitoring and tuning. So limitations, also how to deal in a great big ecosystems with hundreds and hundreds of microservices. And the other is data preparation and data in data science. So tips and tricks. So general discussion. If someone does it, how you do it, what you do it. That's pretty much it.
Just a tip. You can do it. Just pass the mic around. You don't have to walk away. You know, walk to the center of the room to just. No, you can. I'm just suggesting that it doesn't have to be that burden that people have to move around.
Hi, my name is Frank. I would like to have a discussion about Java decompilers, their pros and cons. It should not be a discussion about the techniques, how they work. It should be more about the benefits that they exist, and also about the risk that they exist, because they can reveal the logic of your application.
Hi, my name is Thomas. I don't have a session to propose other than what you guys already said.
This is just random, right?
To contribute there. But I recently started working with Hairline.
The way we
debug systems in production, tracing inside Hairline, it's amazing.
It's
very hard for me to go back to Java and try to debug something live. So in Hairline, when you try to do tracing, you basically say, I want Erlang is a functional programming language, so we basically say on any production system live, I want to trace this function, what are the arguments passed in, what's the output of this function, and you can easily just attach to any production live server and get this debugging statements in a file and then later on analyze them and find out what's wrong. In Java, where I come from, it's usually a heavy shitload, sorry for the word, of debugging if statements to find if we want to debug and only the stuff that we already programmed the code to have debug statements for, not everything.
Exactly.
So I would like to hear if there is any experience from someone else around.
Start moving things around.
But about tracing live systems somewhere. With any kind of tooling that doesn't affect performance on the system when it's not used.
Out of the equation. It stays there.
My name is.
This is how it works.
And I want
that thing is, I don't
about
know where
the price of testing. How make such simple, even easy than usual unit testing? Is using such simple tool as JBoss Aquilion.
My name is Andrei.
Hey, yes.
I want to discuss as well unit and integration testing, how to make it correctly. What test to write, what not to write, what tools to use, and as well, I'm interested in the future of Java.
What about this? Why this is not on the market?
Hello, my name is Gregor. I like business. To talk about your functional Java 8 technology stack. Basically, the Java 8 functional library stream API is kind of lagging in one or the other area. I'd like to know what kind of libraries or if you use any other technologies to kind of get around this. Yeah. Kirkjan. I'd like to propose one topic about, well, basically to generally call it enterprise JavaScript. A general topic about JavaScript, obviously we all agree it sucks, but what is in that landscape, what is useful there, how do we translate our existing Java technologies and skills into that landscape, is it even possible, those kinds of topics, JavaScript in an enterprise environment.
Anyone else? Anybody else wants to propose?
Somebody else would like to propose a session.
Or are we done? Are we done? Done.
For now.
So done. 1001. 1002.
It's worth mentioning that as time passes by during the on conference, if you feel like there is a new topic that you would like to raise, just simply write down a post-it, put in the launch pad, and on the recesses, everybody's going to look at what is there, and we can organize later, or try to disorganize how we're going to do. So if you don't see something right now, you will see it later, right?
Yes. Okay, so what are we gonna do now? Now we have launch pad complete, and the disorganizers and some of the conveners already start filling up the slots for basically today. So the main goal is that we fill up two sessions for now, and by end of today or beginning of tomorrow, we're gonna basically complete the schedule. So those interested into making sure they make it into the right session and that they don't have colliding sessions, they don't have to be in three rooms at the same time, please go to the launch pad and the schedule, but don't all run there, like 100 people, because it just doesn't work. Just make sure you cluster like in 10, 15 people max and just figure out things and move post-its around. If you are a convener of one of the sessions and you see, for example, that you need the time until Wednesday to prepare something, just put your sticker directly into the Wednesday thing. So without further ado, let's spend like 10, 15 minutes max. Let's finish Monday. Monday is very important, then we just go to the session. We are off by at least 15 minutes. We were supposed to start 5 minutes ago with the first session, but we'll just shift it. So once the Monday is ready, we just say, let's say 10:30 or whatever, we go there for a session.